lot of change, a new manager, running the cup, and from a mid-table team to top of the table, you know. So it has been an eventful year. Stadium's been now complete a year. The support's always been there. You know, they're coming out in the thousands now. I mean, the average must be 24, 25 every week. And they're getting right behind the team. And the team, you know, is responding to the fans, to be fair. This is my fifth season now at Molineux. It's well over 4 years ago when I came. And we only had two sides of a ground. You know, we had a ground that was, you know, over one side, half a stand over one side, and a bit of terracing. But the support's always been there. The support's been, you know, phenomenal. And you know, it was still a pleasure coming to the Wolves. And we've had four seasons while I've been here of mid-table. On a personal turn, the high point's got to be being selected for the England B squad. That was, funnily enough, Graham Taylor selected me. I mean, it's ironic, you know, things come round, don't they, they say, and that's how it is. You know, the FA Cup run last season was a great run, getting to the quarterfinals and playing Chelsea. I mean, that's almost got to be like almost one of the high points and a low spot as well, because losing to Chelsea 1-0, where we felt we could have got a lot more out of it, and if we'd have got them back at Molineux, I thought we could have beaten them. That was disappointing. The gaffer Graham Turner going, that was a disappointment, you know, in not being able to see the job through. He'd brought Wolves so far and, you know, just couldn't get us into the Premier. You know, that was a shame for him.
The year of 1994 started in style at Molineux with a visit of Bolton Wanderers. Both sides made the best of some farcical conditions that almost led to the match being postponed. Wolves triumphed thanks to a 21st minute goal from Robbie Dennison. However, the conditions led to some embarrassing moments in front of goal. The visitors, inspired by Jason McAteer, piled on the pressure, but the Wolves' defence was strong enough to hold on for all 3 points. A 1-0 victory meant a satisfactory start to the year for Wolves. The draw for the FA Cup third round pitted Wolves against Crystal Palace, and an enthralling encounter was decided by David Kelly, who rifled home a loose ball late into the second half. Molineux went wild as Wolves progressed to the fourth round for only the second time in 11 years. Rankin with the throw. Touch inside from Cook. Clearance only as far as Mark Venus. Difficult ball for Kelly on that surface, but Venus again whips a crossing ball on the back post and headed away under pressure. Cook hits it long. Appeals for handball. Dennison picks it up again for Wolves. Takes on Southgate. Southgate falls and almost touches it with his hand, but the cross coming in, headed away by Young, and a good save. Nigel Martin. This could be a chance. Oh, and pushed away by Martin again. Greenis looking for the run of Andy Thompson. He gets round Richard Smith. Well, good saving tackle in the end, but Dennison could pick it up again for Wolves. He does. Now Cook. Neat chest down for Keane. Ball's there. On the clearance. Cook. Outside of the boot to Dennison now. Thompson. Cook. Lovely ball again for Dennison. Good control on the surface from Wolves. Ball looks for space. Good save in the end by Martin. The Wolves still searching for that all-important goal. They want to win this match at home. They don't want to take it to a replay. Dennison now, can he provide the cross? It's a good cross towards the back post. Rankin's there. Corner to Wolves. Martin comes, not a convincing punch. Kelly's there. Surely puts Wolves through to the fourth round. Keane. Dennison, the second, sticking away. Kelly. Good chip cross. Regis is coming in. Oh, what a gilt-edged opportunity for the veteran to put it beyond doubt. The league leaders return 7 days later. But this time, Wolves went one better. Keane gets the cross in. Danger still not cleared for Crystal Palace. They had eight defenders back in their own box there, but still Wolves pick up the ball. This time, Chris Marsden. Venus venturing forward from the back. Gets a beautiful return pass. Oh, and just pushed it too long. Ferguson, it was, got his head in the way of that one. Ball. Keane now, sprinting away down that far side. Gets it back to Steve Ball. Came off Richard Smith, but Wolves will get the throw. Ball battling forward. And eventually wins it. And surely brought down Eric Young, the offender. Yes, it's a penalty to Wolves. No doubt about it. Thompson makes it 1-0 to Wolves. Lethal from the penalty spot. Kelly did well to get a touch on that at all, really. And gets away from Young again. Well, that's surely another penalty. Good header away, but back in. Oh, and a tremendous save by Nigel Martin, but the danger's still not here. And eventually Martin picks it up. The Wolves have had the better of the play throughout this game and really have taken it to the league leaders. And that's another corner. Rankin looking for some movement up front and finds it with Bull. That's good control from Bull. Oh, and even better. And Keane's there. Yes, it's 2-0. Kevin Keane, after tremendous work by Steve Ball down the right. Having beaten Port Vale 2-0 in the fourth round of the FA Cup, Wolves faced Premiership Ipswich at home in the fifth round.
Waiting for Stuart Slater, and that strikes Shirtley. Well, it's a corner now. Oh, and Walsh there, and it puts you in the lead. It's the veteran. Well, the goalkeeper Stowe will not be pleased there. As he, well, John Walk, one of his most famous cup goals, came in that semi-final. But here are Wolves, and Thompson's in here. Thompson should have equalised almost immediately. Oh, it's come off Marshall. Shirtliff. Oh, yeah, outrageous.
Thompson. Now he's onside, chance to cross. Regis up with, oh, he's missed it, the keeper. Kelly! Oh, how did they get that away? Well, goal. Ferguson. Oh, and a good challenge by Linegan. Now Rankin. Thompson! Oh, what a save by Craig Morris. Molyneux, as Marsden prepares to take the corner, can he pick out Shirtliff? Venus comes off Ward. Ferguson! What happened there? Played by Geraint Williams. Blades, Marsden. Regis. Kelly! Goal! It's David Kelly, and it's 1-1. And the Wolves supporters get the moment they've been waiting for. They had to wait until the 82nd minute for it, but the goal has come at last, and David Kelly, who by his standards has been going through a lean spell in front of goal, gets the assistance here of big Cyril Regis. That's the layoff they were working for. It's an angled shot for Kelly, and he fires it beyond Forrest.
After the excitement of the FA Cup heroics against Ipswich Town and before the replay at Portman Road, it was back to league action and the visit of struggling Birmingham City. Regis feeds it outside for Keane. Thompson's on the overlap, that's a good cross in, and Regis is there! The simplest of tasks for Cyril Regis on the back post to knock the ball over the line from just 2 yards after the ball came through a crowd of players from Andy Thompson's cross. Cyril Regis makes it 1-0 with the easiest goal he'll ever score. Thompson, barring it back to his keeper. And Kelly's way offside there. Play continues, O'Keane isn't offside. Well, the Blues defence has stopped and David Kelly scores! Well, the Blues defender's going wild with the linesman and the referee there. David Kelly was definitely in an offside position as that ball was headed forward. Obviously, the linesman and referee judged that he wasn't seeking to gain advantage or interfering with play. But how much do you want to interfere with play rather than score the goal? And there it was on hand to finish off Kevin Keane's cross. Blues are livid, but it's 2-0 to Wolves. Both sides have coped well with this difficult surface. Outside for Rankin now. Good cross. Masters! What a tremendous shot! And it comes back to Keane and trickles in off his feet. Well, most incredible goal. Mark Rankin got in a good cross from the right and eventually came to Masters, who blasted it against the crossbar and dislodged all the snow, and Kevin Keane applied the finishing touch to make it 3-0. February the 22nd was also the night on which Wolves revealed their latest innovation in the rebuilding of Molyneux, the video wall. After a nail-biting fifth-round finish at Molyneux, Wolves headed off to Suffolk to try and finish the job at Portman Road against Premier League Ipswich Town in the fifth round of the FA Cup.
Wolves kick off. The players will appreciate the better surface here at Portman Road. At Molineux, they have pitch problems despite the sumptuous setting around the stadium. It's a night where at least their supporters will expect Ipswich to really carry the fight for the side from the Ensley First Division. Ferguson takes. Oh, and it's put away by Lee Mills. What a fairy tale. 8 minutes gone, unstoppable up in the top corner. Forrest amazed, I think, that the ball came back Mills' way, but he wasn't taken by surprise. He flashed it in.
Well, they don't clean it. It's as simple as that. Two of the players get in each other's way. I think it's Grant Williams can only knock it back into Lee Mills' path. Up he goes, Grant Williams, knocks it straight to Mills, who puts it straight in the top corner. And even at 6'4", Forrest has no chance.
Well, with it as John Watt had. Wolves who had a lot of early corners. And another one here. Dennison, found by his opposite number, Grant Williams.
Well, he takes this down very well, doesn't he? Look at that. Kills it perfectly. He's away on the turn with his next touch.
He's got good technique, as we were saying, Robbie Dennison, and he's very much a threat at set pieces. Scored a couple of spectacular goals at Wembley in various competitions. Andy Thompson, who's invited to let fly, deflected, it's 2-0. 7 minutes to go to half-time, and Andy Thompson, who came so close in the first game at Molineux, twice there denied by Craig Forrest, nothing that Forrest could do about it here.
Right out of the training ground, Ferguson rolls it across to Thompson, he hits it there. I don't know whether it's John Watt who's trying to clear it, but it's straight from the training ground. There he hits it. It's David Lennigan who's trying to head it clear, and all he can do is head it into the top corner. How you feel for a goalkeeper in a situation like this? He has got no chance, Craig Forrest. Look at that. Play alongside Watt and Lennigan. They've kept Stuart Slater on this near side, so he's on the right wing now. But they've put Mick Stockwell into the centre of midfield area.
Hoping it'll fall. Away it has done. Steve Palmer. Inside the first minute of the second half. And Wolves caught cold, hesitating in their own penalty area, and Palmer bounced.
Well, again, a defence doesn't clear a header. But what's the difference for Ipswich here? They've got players coming from midfield, getting in the box. Now they've got Stockwell and Palmer arriving at the same time, and Palmer's the one who buries it in the corner.
With Ipswich Town out of the way, could Wolves take another Premiership scalp at Stamford Bridge?
It's a touch too long, is it? No, it's not. Hesitation by the goalkeeper. The wind held that up a little bit. It looked as though it was going to run straight to Dimitri Harin. Instead, it was almost ideal for Whittingham.
Well, that was a classic win situation, because it looks as if Curry's going to take it comfortably, gets caught short, and Whittingham, if it had just diverted it in the right direction, Wolves would have been one up.
Early. Shetliff takes it away from Wise. Early ball in from Hoddle. Wise, Burley, challenge just in time, but now the follow-up by Peacock, and Chelsea had the lead. Telling goal by Gavin Peacock. Huddle's early ball in. Wise found the width.
challenge looked as though it was in time, but it wasn't, and Peacock, under pressure from Venus, guided it past Mike Starr.
Well, they managed to get all those passes on the floor, didn't they? Wires, Burley, and then it was Peacock pushed up front since Spencer went off, and no chance for Stowe.
Marsden, they've got men over here, Wolves! And the opportunity is not taken by Guy Whittingham. They had three over. Curling cross, look at that, three at the back. Not any of them marked, and it came off the head of Whittingham and wide at the far post.
Barely 48 hours after the defeat at Chelsea, and with players, staff and supporters still feeling the after effects, Wolves' exit from the cup was followed by a costly defeat at Fratton Park, Portsmouth.
Pethick into service. Now Craney looks to get it on his left, chance for Chamberlain. Great shot from Mark Chamberlain. What a superb goal! And now Kelly. Ferguson, keen again. And Whittingham's in space, and Whittingham! Simpson still forward, Simpson steals.
After this 3-0 reverse, Cross Wolves drop to 13th place in the table, some way off the promotion pace setters. The next morning, Wolves manager of 7 years, Graham Turner, phoned chairman Jonathan Hayward to offer his resignation.
It came after the Chelsea game live on the Sunday, the quarter final. The atmosphere almost said it all in the dressing room. We beat 1-0, and it was the quietest dressing room I've ever heard. You know, I think nobody moved for half an hour. Nobody said a word. The gaffer couldn't speak. The players couldn't speak, and you know, you felt something was wrong. You know, I know we'd been beat, and you are disappointed after losing a game, especially a big game like that. But for nobody to move and speak for half an hour, it was eerie. And what had happened, we'd gone straight from that game down to Portsmouth, as that game was on the Tuesday night, and it was a big anti-climax Portsmouth game. They were a good team at the time, playing at home, and we'd just been knocked out of the quarterfinals of the cup, and something was wrong, and the players sensed it. I think everybody sensed it, and we got a good hiding 3-0, and we all performed poor, and that was the last time Graham Turner was in charge, and we all heard it the next day. It was strange as well, because he never really announced anything to the players. It just came out the next day that he'd resigned, and it was a bit of a lull really amongst the club and the players.
Did the players feel responsible?
I think players as a whole, if you've been with a manager for a long time, you do feel a sense of guilt. You feel maybe you could have done that a little bit more, maybe you could have worked harder for him, especially if you've played for him, you know, for any length of time and been in his team for all the time. But you've got to get on, it's a profession. The managers carry the can, that's how it is, you know. They drop players, buy players, so on that they've got to sort of like carry the can and say, well, I bought the players and the players didn't do it, so I've got to go.
He had nearly 7.5 years at Molineux as manager. When you reflect on it, he did a great job for the club, didn't he?
Fantastic. I think when he resigned, there was a lot of praise heaped on him, and that's unusual. Usually if a manager resigns or gets a sack, usually it's farewell and that's the end of it. But with Graham Turner, the fans and the chairman and Sir Jack, they all realised how much he actually did for Wolves, because when he took over Wolves, you know, the Wolves fans have realised they were going out of the league.
Peter Shurtliff led Wolves out at Charlton, not just as skipper, but as caretaker manager, as they went in search of a promotion playoff place. Thompson. Whittingham turns. He's gone past one challenge, he's gone past two! He's only got the keeper to beat, and he does! What a tremendous finish by Guy Whittingham! Superb goal by the on-loan striker. He picked up the ball in the centre circle, went past one challenge, went past a second, and then finished in style to make it Wolves 1, Charlton 0. Vernon Nelson kick off. What a superb finish by Guy Whittingham that was. Could be trouble now down the left. Oh, what an excellent challenge by Peter Shirtliff.
Sir Jack's put so much money into it. He's made it into a Premier League club, stadium, facilities, everything. And he's willing to put more money into it to buy a player. So he was out looking for the biggest name he could get to come in and to do the job. And there was no surprise Graham Taylor came here. It was just a matter of who it was. I mean, we had a great selection list, didn't we? Brian Robson, Jerry Francis and Graham Taylor. How many teams do you hear like trying to get a manager? And we've got three of the best lined up, and then we've got the pick of them in the end. We had three games under Peter Shirtliff, who did an excellent job. It was hard for him, being a player, to actually manage the rest of the players, but it was still a feeling in the club, well, when's something going to be sorted? And then as soon as Graham Taylor was named as manager, I mean, the lift was enormous. I mean, players all throughout the squads, I mean, the reserve players, everybody, then have got to lift the game to prove to Graham Taylor, what they can do and that they can play for him, because he might have, kept an eye on us in the papers and, odd clips on TV, but he really wouldn't have known many of the players. And he had to come and get to know them, and you had to prove yourself. So all the way through the club, we went out to prove ourselves. It was like a new beginning. It was like signing for a new club and a new manager and saying, right, this is what I can do. And we had something like 10 or 12 games left in the league to do that, and we set about it, and I thought we did rather well for that. When he first came, the lads really got themselves going and fired up.
There was a lot of pressure on him as well, wasn't there, when he first came, the turnip thing and all the pressure in the press. It wasn't just a test of the players, it was a test of Graham Taylor as well, wasn't it?
Yeah, he admitted that he was always going to take a lot of stick for the England thing, and not only that, the video came out, didn't it, with "Do I Not Like That?" And he took a lot of stick on that, and he was a man in the public eye, and the press had given him a hard time. So, I mean, all our fans got right behind him. The fans were superb to him, and he took to them straight away. But I mean, obviously you got 91 league clubs there who were going to give him a stick and call him, and he accepted that. He didn't hide away from it, and he stood by his beliefs, and that's why he's here today. Just because he's been an England manager and that, it doesn't mean he's completely different. He's mad, but he has some ideas. He has some different ideas, obviously. But I think he's more demands. I think that's what I'd sort of put it down to more than ever. He's a more demanding manager, and I think that's shown.
On the day Graham Taylor took over, there was little for the local commentators to cheer at Bolton.
Quick breakthrough and a good save there by Davison, but following up to put Wolves 1-0 in front. It looks like Whittingham, if indeed it is, number 9, Guy Whittingham. Davison stood up well, first of all, to make the save, but Guy Whittingham, like a good striker, he is sniffing in to put the ball in the net.
Now McAtee with a good cross into McGinley! Yes! John McGinley, what a good goal! Super John, but a good header from Owen Coyle down to McGinley, and that was good play. And the boys with the chant there, Bruce Rioch Super Light Army, and Bruce, the chant ringing out that's now become so famous down here. And a chance here for Wolves, Guelte in goal, a mistake once again, the ball dropping to Wolves fullback number 2, Andrew Thompson, and from close range, making no mistake whatsoever.
Yeah, once again, do we put that down to a defensive error, Dave?
Oh, indeed, you've got to say a mix-up in the defence.
The Porter's behind the goal. Good header by Stubbsy, finds Phillips. Phillips dispossessed, Whittingham out to Rankin. Rankin puts it over, and Davison just waving a fist. Oh, dear me, Dave.
Well, I said it, our defence is suspect. You've got to say that was a defensive mistake without a doubt.
Well, you never like to apportion blame, but you don't like to be critical of people at all. But I think you're right there. I've got to put that one down to another defensive error.
Well, I say goalkeeper completely misjudged it.
Graham Taylor received a rapturous welcome from a full house before his first game in charge at Molineux, and Wolves got off to a winning start for their new manager. It's a good flick on by Lee Mills, and Whittingham's in. He's round the keeper. He scored. It's 1-0. Nixon left helpless. A great flick on by Lee Mills. It was from the long ball by Mike Stowell. And there was Whittingham with only the keeper to beat, and he made no mistake. Tranmere prepared to patiently look for the opening. Neat into passing, and now could be problems. Aldridge is in the centre, and he scored! John Aldridge puts Tranmere level. It was a patient build-up by Tranmere, and a good ball in, and there was the predatory striker, John Aldridge, to make it 1-1. Shielded by Cyril Regis. Thompson, Regis again, neat turn, trying to go all the way through himself, but Mills picks it up and scores. A left foot shot from Lee Mills. Some great work by Cyril Regis to create the opportunity in the first place, but Mills swings his left boot at it and puts it out of the reach of Eric Nixon, and surely gives Wolves 3 points with only a couple of minutes left to play. Nine points from three games had moved Wolves into eighth place in the table. But a 4-0 thrashing at Oxford, followed by a 1-1 draw at home to bottom of the table Peterborough United, meant that their pursuit of a playoff place was faltering. They needed a victory at Luton Town. Mark Burke, returning from a loan spell at Luton, made light of the difficult conditions at Kenilworth Road to put Wolves ahead. It took a goal line clearance from Andy Thompson to preserve Wolves' first half lead. As well as an excellent save from David Priest by Wolves keeper Mike Stowell. Guy Whittingham made sure of all 3 points with a powerful shot that Luton keeper Jürgen Sommer could only deflect into the net. Wolves continued their push for the playoffs at Notts County.
Play on, said the referee. What has the referee given? He's given a penalty. And the Notts County players rushed across to the linesman. It was the linesman that gave the signal. The referee accepted it. And so Andy Thompson against Steve Cherry. And the county players are still incensed with that. It certainly looked accidental from up here. But after all the pressure they've been under, Wolves have got the opportunity to go into the lead through Andy Thompson against Steve Cherry. and it's there. Sneaks in the corner. Cherry goes the right way, but can't stop it. And Wolves go into what is undoubtedly an undeserved lead. Burke was offside, surely. Whittingham. Shot comes in and it's there. And that surely is it. And Gary McSwiggan goes across to the linesman on the far side. Mark Burke surely was offside when that ball came in. The linesman kept his flag down. And Notts County's proud home record takes another dent.
A defeat away at Millwall meant that Wolves had to win their handful of remaining games to have any chance of making the playoffs. Good ball by Cook for Bull. There might be a foul, but Whittingham picks it up. Can he score? Guy Whittingham picking up the pieces after Steve Bullock and marauding through the Luton Town defence. Makes it 1-0 from the edge of the area. Kept in play by Bennett. Whittingham, Birch, neat chip. Oh, it's over the keeper, but it hit the bar. Burke back in. Good. He's only got Summer to beat. Oh, an inches past the post by Steve Bull. Full house at Molyneux on the last day of the season applauded Wolves' brave sprint to the finish that so nearly snatched a playoff spot. There was little to play for either side, but it was an enthralling game nonetheless. Leicester, already having secured their place in the playoffs, made life hard for the home side and took the lead after some slack Wolves defending. David Kelly did pull Wolves level in the second half to give them their 13th one-all draw of the season and 17th draw in the league overall. Too many drawn games and too many near misses have been the story of Wolves' season in 93-94. As Graham Taylor made his way down the tunnel following the final match of the season, he knew he had a busy summer ahead of him.
The gaffer's obviously from his time with England, he's always had the best of things, and he's spoken to the top psychologists, the top nutritionists, and he's got some ideas, and you know, these foreign teams as well, they've all got these ideas, and I think he's picked up a few tips. And I think one of the biggest that he's brought in two blokes who train athletes, and he's brought in somebody as well for the nutrition. And it's been very much down this season to a lot of weights, a lot of running and a lot of good eating, and he's installed that into us. You know, he doesn't force feed us, but he sort of spells it out, what is good for us and what is bad for us. But through the work we've done in the summer, and we're carrying it on now, you see, I think the biggest change is we've done pre-season before in the past, like 4 or 5 weeks. It's all condensed into 5 weeks of just sheer running, hard work, weights, and then you take the foot off the accelerator, and then you just do football. And come like January, February, your legs are tired, you lose your aerobic capacity, and then you slow down that little bit. You lose maybe 5 or 6%. It might not seem a lot, but out on the pitch it probably will, you know. But now the gaffer's brought these blokes in, and they're with us through the season now. And the squad now we've got we've got a fantastic squad. I mean, the injuries we've had this season have been phenomenal again. Yet we've coped, and we're still top of the league with them injuries. So hopefully when everyone's fit, we should be flying. But he's strengthened the squad, you know, and he's got pace there with Daly and Froggatt. I mean, raw pace. And Neil Emblem's been a revelation in midfield. And they are good buys. Now, there's nothing to stop the gaffer from buying any more throughout this season. But, you know, I say it gives you a lift, it gives you a boost, and certain players it puts pressure on, in a good sense, to sort of keep them G'd up and get them going. And it's been a great competition for places.
The season began with what, on reflection, was a great victory over Reading.
Header down for Bull. Bull threading it inside. Ferguson now! Another great save, but they won't stop Froggatt's follow-up. Wolves take the lead inside the first 10 minutes. And what a dream of a debut it is for Steve Froggatt. Ferguson takes much of the credit. Hislop thought he'd done enough, but Froggatt following in scores the first goal. Perfect start for Wolves. And a wonderful start for Steve Froggatt. Again towards Lovell. And here for Osborne. And Osborne's worked his way in. Reading have certainly contributed to the game in terms of goals, and yeah, this might be one. And Stowell again makes the stop to prevent Little equalising. Stowell's had to find the end, making saves whatever he's had to do. Level getting on the end of the cross was aimed just inside the upright. For Reading, this could be their last attack, their last chance to get something from the opening game of the season. Lovell has got Kerr, and here's Jilks. What a good chance this one is. Jilks for Quinn. It's definitely not his on Reading's day. Hammered it over the top, and surely this is as good a chance as any striker could ask for.
Black Country rivals Albion were the visitors at the end of August, and Wolves fans were looking for revenge.
And looking for Thomas in the middle. Phelan got it half clear. Thomas almost fell to him. Good early pressure from Wolves. Smith. Garton denies him room, but Birch makes the cross. Emblem is on the far post. Paul Blaise for Wolves. Kelly's done well there and goes down, and that could be a penalty, and it is.
The challenge by Burgess was rash, to say the very least, and I don't think the referee had any option other than to award a penalty.
The ironic thing about this is he actually fouled him outside the box and then fouled him again. The initial foul, Burgess actually grabbed Kelly's shirt. So he just gets all of his shirt outside the box. And then when he's eventually gone down, he's in the penalty box.
So for the second week in succession, Andy Thompson has the chance from the penalty spot to score for Wolves. His goal meant an equaliser a week ago at Notts County.
Slotted penalty, this, isn't it? Right up past Stuart Naylor's right hand. Actually, a far better penalty than the one he took last week against Notts County.
Here's Birch. Smith. What a lovely layoff to Kelly. And Kelly's done well. Great save again from Naylor. Had it not been for Stuart Naylor, the game would have been won by now for Wolves.
To match them.
Simplest goal he'll ever score. Well, we're well into stoppage time now, and Wolves have got it back and might be able to round things off here as Venus goes forward. Ferguson is in a good position. Well, he was looking for the glory goal at the end there. You can't blame him, I suppose, but Darren Ferguson was well placed.
You've said it all there.
This is one of those, I mean, nothing else but the goals.
As Wolves supporters travelled north to Roker Park on September the 3rd, the news emerged that Billy Wright had passed away peacefully that morning. The Wolves legend was a constant inspiration to everyone at Molineux, and the minute's silence was respected by everyone inside Roker Park. A measure of the affection with which Billy was held, not only by Wolves fans, but by football supporters throughout the country.
Russell looking for Goodman. Gray at full speed. Gray! A superb goal for Gray! An outstanding move. The finish to match. Look at Gray moving from midfield. He was going like a train. That was a great first touch, and the finish impeccable. Goodman steaming here. Phil Gray, great save, Stowell, and again Wolves torn apart. Gray absolutely bubbling with the advantage. Wolves with other ideas. Knocked on the near post there by Blades. Ward away. First time and in the back of the net there, Mark Venus. And again, Sunderland can't hold on to a lead. And it was punished there by Venus. The Wolves fans celebrate. So too, the lad from Hartlepool. The North East born player then. Back level, Ward with a header in there. Sunderland didn't get it completely away, and it was an excellent strike. Atkinson finding Goodman. Gray's in the middle there. Gray! Great reactions from the keeper. And another terrific move between Goodman and Gray.
It was a strange day for us, to be fair. Nobody had really warned us about Billy's illness. I think it was sort of like quietly kept secret throughout the club. And we knew he wasn't particularly well because we hadn't seen him during this season. But we'd been overnight at Sunderland, and we got up in the day And the gaffer sort of came on, the team coach was, and said, Billy Wright's died. And there was nothing to be said, really. I mean, it, you know, the lads just, it was quiet. You know, nobody really knew what to say. It was a big shock. You know, and we then thought, well, we've got a game here. And, you know, it was a wonder. You had two things on your mind. You know, you didn't know what to think for Billy and his wife. And you didn't really know with the game coming up. And it was a quiet dressing room, but you know, as we're paid to do in professional footballers, you know, we had to put the game in the forefront of our minds, and that's what we did. We paid our respects before the game, which was, you know, it was eerie in itself when you've got, you know, 20,000 supporters, and you know, you chant loud and all that, and you could hear a pin drop. And the best way we felt we could do him justice was to go out and put a performance on, and it turned out to be a battling performance more than anything. And then the rest of the week, really, it was eerie and it was quiet, and we tried to get on with life as you could do. And the club, you know, really did well for, you know, paying the respects, and, you know, I think we did quite well for him in the end. But you could talk to him for hours. I mean, he used to talk to everybody and anybody. He wouldn't just walk past and you go, oh, there was Billy Wright. He'd say, hiya, Billy, all right, and, you know, and he'd come over and talk to you. He used to go to the reserve games. Every game there was at Wolves, he'd go. He'd go to the Youth Cup, he'd go to the reserves, he'd go to the... and he was a fabulous bloke who loved football, and he loved Wolverhampton Wanderers. And you can't say enough about him, to be fair. And I mean, there's been some great tributes, and they're all, you know, fair. And you know, we went to the funeral, we did that, and we felt the best way we could do it with Tranmere at home was to again try and put on a performance in that, and I think we did that. I mean, anybody who's played for England that many times and captain, he's met the best and talked to everybody. But it wouldn't be just players he'd talk to. He'd talk to the tea lady, he'd talk to supporters. Anybody who turned up and say, hello, Billy, he'd go over and talk to them. And that was the type of bloke he was. He was a fabulous, fabulous fella, and he will be missed. And, you know, it's a sad loss for the club and for football. But, you know, let's hope we can have a fitting tribute for him in the city. And the statue's got to be about right.
Home league debut, Paul Stewart immediately made his presence felt.
Nixon's long kick downfield. Again giving Venus something, work to do with his head. It's a good ball forward though for Stewart. And that's trickling through and underneath the keeper. Stewart scores. Goes down injured. Nixon remonstrates with his defenders. Again, the long ball forward that's been so productive for Wolves this season, and the simplest of touches underneath the advancing keeper earned Paul Stewart his first goal for Wolves, and also some attention from the physio. Thomas chips it in, headed away, but only as far as irons, but it's Neil Emblin to bring it away for Wolves. Outside for Walters. Smith is screaming for it out to his right. Ahead of him is Kelly, who chooses Froggatt. Froggatt does a little bit of a dance, but it doesn't fool Tony Thomas. Wolves get the throw in down below us. Again with his back to goal, tries to find the space, but Emblin, and what a great goal by Neil Emblin. Emblin celebrates, the ball came back to him after a toe had been put in behind Steve Ball, and he hit an unstoppable shot from the edge of the area. Neil Emblin with his second goal for Wolves after his opener against Watford at Vicarage Road.
Morrissey.
chipped back in, and O'Brien's there and fires just wide. Stowell is livid with his defence, and O'Brien just looks heavenward and knows he should have done better. It was unlucky September the 13th for Southend as Wolves stepped over Middlesbrough to take pole position in style.
And he can try again, and that's a better looking ball, and it almost produced a goal, and it did produce a goal! Beautifully finished off by Emblem when it looked as though Southend had survived the worst moment.
Great cross in, really super cross put in, and really you've got to say that Southend's goalkeeper Paul Sampson, a bit unlucky there, but Neil Emblem was there backing up, and that's what all players have got to do in the back of the net.
Venus looking for either Bull or Kelly on the edge of the box. It's Bull who gets it and is dispossessed, and no offside decision. Great roar. It's gone in, what a bizarre goal! However, they all count. Kelly claiming it, it got a massive deflection, and Wolves have scored 2 in 2 minutes. Well, that's as strange a goal as you'll see.
Well, I'm not sure about it. I think it probably was offside, but it was played back by a Southend player, so maybe not. Oh, it was a dodgy one, wasn't it? But they all count. Kelly read it to a little bit, to be fair.
Somehow Wolves just look so much stronger than the Southend players. It's almost like a good youth team playing against a bunch of senior pros who are that much tougher and stronger.
Walters with another excellent cross. Ah, and still chances. Kelly turns it in. It's a goal. Froggatt makes it 3. And all the goals, if you can call goals ugly, have been just that. But no one at Molineux is complaining.
Now, another Walters cross, and isn't he done that well this game? And really, from then on, it's another mix-up. Good lay-back by Kelly, though. Easy peasy for Stevie Froggatt. But you can see nobody really getting in a tackle at Southend.
Southend have a corner now. They've wasted just about everyone they've had so far. Can they make better use of this one? The answer is no. Mark Walters winning it back then, and just kept in play. It's excellent play by Wolves. Really well there, Kelly. Now Thompson finding Emblem. And they're stretched here, Southend, and he just ran one man too far, straight into Ronnie Whelan. However, Jones has given it away. Mark Walters, Emblem again, making an intelligent run for him. He tries the shot! What a superb finish! A quality goal from a quality player. Mark Walters makes it 4.
I think he's had a great game tonight, Mark Walters. His distribution on the ball is brilliant, and this sums it up. Takes his time, beautifully flighted shot, knew exactly where he was going to put it. Super goal, see it from behind the goal. Sampson, no chance. Good effort. Played very well tonight, Mark Walters.
They'll take the corner short and quickly this time. Poole, a substitute in possession. It down the Hunt across, and Stowell made an easy catch. Confident running by Froggatt, he's easily got round Ronnie Whelan. Bull in the middle, no problem. Brilliant ball, superb finish. Wolves 5, Southend 0. Sunderland here on the penultimate game of last season. Bullies back. the score sheet again.
Oh, but what a great run and cross by Stevie Froggatt. He left Ronnie Whelan for dead, which is maybe not so difficult, but a great run and cross, and Stevie Ball there. Wonderful football, wonderful football.
Wolves travelled north on September the 17th to Turf Moor to take on newly promoted Burnley, intent on keeping hold of their top spot.
Wolves throw in. Froggatt on that left side for the Wolves now as he teases the Burnley back four. In a great effort there from Kelly, and just, well, it was just wide, and Dale Emblin again wide for Walters. Minicum having to watch him. McMinn puts the ball out, a corner. Corner then for Wolves. Bending one that it is. A flick on from Kelly, and Ball! Steve Ball scores for Wolverhampton Wanderers. A good corner from Ferguson. Kelly got the flick on, and Steve Ball from 6 yards makes it Burnley 0, Wolverhampton Wanderers 1. Third.
Yeah, unfortunate for the Wolves lad to be given offside. I don't think it's in the...
It was a thought of handball, but David S. Really, I thought it was going to break the net.
There's a break from league action as Wolves travel to Chesterfield for the Coca-Cola Cup on September the 20th. Park has never been a happy hunting ground for Wolves until September the 24th, that is.
Look at this run here from Simons. Is he going to go all the way? Still Simons. Brought down, and it's a penalty. Terrific run by Simons. My word, the captain led by example then. And as he went past Blades, he left his leg trailing, and it's a penalty. Marvellous opportunity this for Portsmouth. Just over 10 minutes gone. Surging burst through that by Kit Simons, and Wolves had no answer to him other than to bring him down. Jerry Craney will take the kick. And scores! Portsmouth take the lead. Ferguson with the throw. Walters set himself up for the shot! What a finish by Mark Walters. The second goal for the club on loan, and that really was a spectacular finish by the former Aston Villa, Glasgow Rangers, and of course Liverpool player. And if Liverpool see that goal on the television tonight, well, they may well think they'd like it back again. A bit hard to see from here,
And I would think he was right. Touched off by Kelly, Ferguson. Now Bull, Kelly. This is dangerous, still Kelly! Portsmouth were torn apart then. Kelly with the finish. They were lethal on the break. Ball to Kelly. It was almost a trip here from Simons. He kept his feet, Kelly, and steered it beyond Alan Knight. 3 minutes of time, and Wolves have come from behind to take the lead.
Wolves' victory over Port Vale on October the 1st owed much to two refereeing decisions.
Here's Bull. And they've two men inside the area, and here's a chance for Ferguson, who goes down, and a penalty is given to Wolverhampton Wanderers. Well, the referee had no doubt about Kelly's challenge. Ferguson trying to make progress inside the area is grounded by Tony Kelly. The man on loan from Bolton has conceded a penalty. It'll be Andy Thompson, who's struck two successfully already this season, who has the chance to give Wolves the lead. Wolves have been struggling, but Thompson finds the net now. It really was what the game needed. Andy Thompson striking it so confidently. It's the perfect penalty just inside the right-hand upright, Musselwhite soundly beaten, Wolves in front. Thompson. That's a huge punt up there for Bull, who takes on two defenders and manages to toe-poke the ball into the way of Walters. Smith is behind Walters, who goes for the short one in, and Van der Laan handled it, and Wolves have a second penalty. Bitter protest led by Dean Glover and Tony Kelly, but the referee very close there. Van der Laan has been on less than 5 minutes, but Mark Walters has given Wolves the chance of a second goal. Second time, it's Thompson against Musselwhite, and for the second time, Thompson wins, and I'm pretty sure now that Wolves are going to win as well. Wolves 2, Port Vale 0, 2 for the popular Andy Thompson. Both from the penalty spot. Kelly. Naylor. Porter, still Porter. The save made now, but not the second time. A goal for Joe Allen. Port Vale are back in it. They're still in the match.
Having suffered only their second defeat of the season at Swindon the week before, Wolves took on a talented Grimsby side at Molyneux.
Oh, well left for Walters. Oh, and the shirt being pulled. Well, definitely there was a shirt pulling there. The referee has awarded the penalty. Yes, I wonder for a moment whether the referee, Mr. Pearce, had spotted it. Indeed, Darren Ferguson was being pulled back as he went to go in and head that ball into the net after Crichton had saved it. And there was no doubt in my mind that Ferguson was being fouled there. And quite rightly, referee Pearce pointing to the spot, and Wolves get yet another penalty, and once more it's Andy Thompson, scorer of four so far this season, who steps up to take on Paul Crichton and scores! Wolves take the lead, 12 minutes gone here at Molyneux, a penalty once again giving Andy Thompson the chance to put Wolves in the lead, and he makes no mistake, 5 out of 5 for the diminutive defender so far this season. It's Wolves 1, Grimsby 0. Now Watson again. Once again, it's Gary Croft to supply the cross. Oh, and it's there! The flick on by Livingston. Well, the ball eventually put in the net, I think, by Paul Groves. But the flick on by Livingston from Gary Croft's cross. And it was Paul Groves who scored it. Grimsby Town get the equalising goal just a minute and a half before half-time. That'll be a Wolves throw. Long by Froggatt into the six-yard box, and it's there by Venus!
Wolves.
Mark Venus arrived perfectly on time. The long throw by Froggatt. It's an added advantage. Well, I'm not sure quite what the referee is having to say to Mark Venus there. I don't suppose it was well done, son. Seemed to be instructing him not to celebrate in front of the crowd, but who can blame him? The perfect timing by Mark Venus arrived just as the ball arrived at his foot in the six-yard box and slotted it under a helpless Paul Crichton to make it 2-1.
Wolves welcome Nottingham Forest to Molineux for the third round of the Coca-Cola Cup on October the 26th. The in-form Premiership team were in unstoppable form in the first 20 minutes, particularly Stan Collymore and Brian Roy. Forest's opening goal was unlucky for the Wolves defence, coming off the knee of Mark Venus. Dutch World Cup star Brian Roy lit up Molineux with some breathtaking skill. One back before the half-time whistle with a precise shot into the far corner. The home fans nearly lifted the roof off the stands as David Kelly nodded in the equaliser from Froggatt's free kick. It was a cruel blow for Wolves after their fabulous fight back, but Stuart Pearce's free kick should take a wild ricochet off the outstretched boot of David Kelly to give Forest a berth in the fourth round. Wolves began the penultimate month of the year in fine form at Ashton Gate.
Steve Froggatt, and there was Paul Walters coming in on the back post to make it 1-0 to Wolves.
Tremendous turn by Ian Bird. Makes it 1-1. Mistake by Mark Humphries, though. The clearance completed by Stuart Munro. Starr having to come out of his area. Puts it forward, and Steve Ball's chasing through on this one. Mark Sherland balling up, surely brought him down. Was it in the area? Well, I'm not sure whether the referee's going to give the penalty, but I think he wants a word with Mark Sherland anyway. Calling Sherland over. I think he may have avoided the penalty. The ball's firm goal. Will this be a red card? The Bristol City number 4, Mark Shirley is. Shirley's up. Thompson against Wells. He scored. Wolves lead restored by Andy Thompson from the penalty spot. And Ferguson's got acres of space. David Kelly's just inside him. Kelly shoots ball under the body of the diving Keith Walsh. You won't be happy with that, the Bristol City keeper. David Kelly looks a little embarrassed, pulls his shirt over his head. But he won't be embarrassed to get on the score sheet. Wolves 3, Bristol City 1. Can he supply the cross? It's low, and it comes out, and David Kelly's there again, and he scored again! 2 for Kelly, 4 for Wolves, it's a rout. The cross came out to David Kelly on the edge of the area, and he buried it. Substitute Paul Stewart. Oh, and it's saved in the cap of the post to Kelly again. It's his hat trick. David Kelly makes it 5 balls. And a hat trick on the night. The second half hat trick for David Kelly. Paul Stewart have done the work, breaking down the left. He tried to angle the low shot. His was pushed up to the post, and there was Kelly to pick up the pieces.
You know, it's a long way. There's a lot of points there to be won, but a team that gets 90 points generally gets out of the league. We're on 31. If the gaffer said we do the same what we've done now, we're out of the league. 93 points, we've won the league and we're there. But it's not just that easy. It sounds so easy. You just carry on what we're doing and we win the league. You know, it sounds great, but we all know that the top of the league team, everybody wants to beat them. Everybody tries harder. You know, wherever we go, we attract big crowds. It's a big game for the small clubs. It's a big game because we attract all our supporters and they turn up to watch us. We've got some big names and they raise the game, and it's a fact. But you know, that's not saying, you know, I never said it was going to be easy. It's always going to be hard. I mean, winning the league is the ultimate. We'd like a cup run. We'd like to go far in the FA Cup again, because last season it was fabulous, the cup. It's a bit of magic about the cup and the atmosphere. But I'd sacrifice everything in the cup. I'd go out in the third round if it meant us winning the league. It's amazing how just one spot changes the outlook of the whole season. I mean, if it was just a normal season with 2 up and 4 playoffs, it just seems automatically, you relax a little bit more and think, well, you know, we're top of the league now, we can afford to maybe just slip the odd point or so and we'll still go up into the Premier. But not now, it's top spot or nothing. I mean, the playoffs are there. I mean, obviously you've got the playoffs if you come second or third, but there's no guarantee then, and then it's a lottery really. They are cup matches then. You know, you've got a two-legged game and then you've got maybe a final. And it is a bit of a lottery after you've played 46 games and worked hard for 46 games. So we don't want to let it slip. We don't want to be in the playoffs We're aiming for top spot, and that's what we're confident of getting. We've got everything there now. We have got everything. We believe we've got everything there. You know, the team is strong enough. We've got enough members. We've got everything. We've got everything. We've got the ground. We've got the fans. We've got the manager. You know, all we're looking for now is, like you say, is to finish the job, and that is up to us. Nobody else can do any more. I mean, Sir Jack's put numerous amounts of money in, and the players know it's about time, you know, we chipped in and finished it off. That's all it is. He's just finishing the job off. And we're on our way, and we're on the course, and 94 is just about to go out the window, and we've got to do it in 95. And it doesn't stop there, you know. Once we're in the Premier, it gets harder, it gets, you know, faster, and we've got to improve once we're in the Premier, because we know like that is a bigger and better league. So we're on the improvement all the time. We're looking to improve things all the time. We're not just happy at what we're doing now. We're happy at being top, obviously, but we want to improve. We want to be top by 10 points. We want to be in the Premier, and then we want to be a good team in the Premier. So, you know, we're looking to improve all the time. But at the moment, we're really focused on winning the league, and that's what we're about to do.